Well, welcome to the second MOOC of the Evolution of Evolution, we call the second week of information. And I'm Keith Christian, and I'm joined here by Professor Janet Browne from Harvard University. As I said last week, Janet is visiting us here as the Darwin Scholar, the first Charles Darwin University Darwin Scholar. So welcome again, Janet.
Hello, everybody. Glad to be back.
Recording started.
Okay, just a quick overview of what we, the material this second week, material in the webinar this second week. We'll talk about some of the topics that we've covered during part two, and we'll also give you the opportunity to participate by chatting, asking questions, and responding to some polling questions, very similar to last week for those of you who were here. Just very briefly, there's a if you want to participate in the chat, you can communicate through the chat. Just ask questions and type in the little box as shown here. And similarly, we'll be conducting some polling. Go to the polling response menu and select the answers, yes or no, or A, B, C, D, whatever. Okay, in the second week, we've covered the following topics: the evolution of evolutionary thought, the way that idea has developed over time, the origin of species, and then we talk, there's a little bit of basic biology, basic theory of evolution, including natural selection and speciation, and then some several examples, including the Galapagos finches as an example of adaptive radiation. And finally, we talk about evolution as a unifying theory in biology. We'll be covering some of these topics in today's webinar. We'll start here in the Galapagos Islands. This is a map of the Galapagos Islands. And Janet, can you just tell us briefly about what parts of the islands that Darwin visited, what he saw?
Yes. You see here the islands, and because of the scale, there's a few really small islands that aren't actually coming up on this map. There's quite a lot of them here in this archipelago. And the names in Darwin's day were English names, so that if you see the island of Santiago, it was in Darwin's day called James Island. So Darwin was there in September 1835. He wrote about it at some length in his Journal of Researches, which you have on your list. He visited four of the islands, whereas the Beagle, the ship, and the captain and the surveying crew visited more. Darwin was let off the boat and was on land on four of the islands. 5 weeks he spent there.
Okay. So did he, some of the places in South America where he got off, there would have been horses, and he would have been able to cover quite a bit of country, but probably on Galapagos he was mostly on foot, do you think?
Yes, Darwin was on foot. He was very excited to visit this archipelago. It had featured in some of the books he had read as being what they thought, actually quite rightly as it turns out, what they thought was new land. It was a very volcanic and bare environment. Darwin was on foot. He had a couple of people with him because the captain never let any of his men off the boat alone unless it was for recreation. So Darwin was at work and he had someone with him. He trekked inland on as many of the islands as he could, so it wasn't just coastal, but he did find most of the organisms he was interested in were coastal.
Okay. We'll just move on and talk a little bit about Darwin in Galapagos today. So there is a research station in the Galapagos Island called Charles Darwin Research Station, run by the Charles Darwin Foundation, and also very heavily involved with the national park, which is, of course, part of Ecuador. And so here on the road into the Charles Darwin Research Station, there's a bust of Darwin. And as we mentioned last week, we talked about in the city of Darwin, there are a lot of places named either after Darwin or probably more likely after the city, which is named after the man.
Yes.
So places like Darwin Pizza and so forth, so all sorts of places that Darwin probably would have never imagined having his name attached to. And there's another place here, this is in Puerto Ayora, so this is the one of the heavily populated islands in the Galapagos, and Puerto Ayora is quite a sizable little town now, and it's a big tourist destination, and his place, a clothing store called Darwin's Cotton. So some of the islands today are completely uninhabited. There are really only sort of two that are have sizable populations. There are two others that have small populations. And pretty much all the rest are uninhabited and maintained as a national park, as I said, by the Ecuadorian government. And I would have to say, very effectively run national park. They're very proactive in conservation efforts, both on the land and in the marine. They've more recently established a marine reserve around the islands, and so the whole sea is protected from overfishing and from all. So they do. I mean, there are a lot of challenges in the Galapagos with introduced species that have been there a long time. Some of them introduced at the time the whalers were visiting the islands. So some of the species have been, and a lot of the plants have caused problems. But generally speaking, despite all these challenges, I think the Ecuadorian government does a great job of managing that national park. Now, briefly mention here that we tend to think, when we think about Darwin's finches, we think about the beak sizes, and that's really heavily discussed in the MOOC material, how the beak sizes have changed depending on the diet of the different finches. But there's also, we need to remember that behavior also evolves, not just physical features. And one example is one that I stumbled on years ago when I was in Galapagos, that on some islands, some of the finches and the mockingbird, which is shown here in this picture, glean ticks and other ectoparasites off the iguanas. The iguanas have a very stereotypical behavior where they stand up on all fours and let the birds walk around underneath them, and they lift their tail and let them pick all the ticks off of them. And so both species have evolved, so there's a behavior associated with the iguana, there's a behavior associated with the birds. But interestingly, some species of birds that are on several islands with goannas don't necessarily have the same behavior. So on some islands, they have this behavior of picking off ticks, and on other islands, the same species just doesn't do it. Mm-hmm. So it again, that sort of gets at the notion that there's no sort of goal to evolution. It either happens and is selected for. So there's at some point in some populations, there was a behavior that arose maybe during a time of food shortages, and they were happy to find a tick or wherever they could find it. But on other islands, that's just never arisen. And so it's evolution is still occurring on Galapagos today. And that's also illustrated here by the finches. They're very tame. Most of the animals on Galapagos are tame, very tame. And the finches are often come and mooch food off of people. On the slide there with the finches sitting on the bowl, they're eating rice. That's at the airport. And this is cooked rice, but a lot of places in and around Puerto Ayora where there are rice is moved around, it's spilt on the ground, and finches readily come in and eat it. And there's some evidence that around Porto or the beak sizes are responding to that introduced grain. So it's a new source of food, and who knows, maybe sometime in the future we'll have rice finches as well. So this is a slide from, would you like to speak
yes.
to that?
It is, exactly. It's a slide from Darwin's Journal of Researches from the second edition, which I know is in your MOOC, really quite a well-known picture of the beaks of the different species of finch. Because it was done a long time ago, Darwin only arranged to have 4 finches depicted. He did actually have 13 different species that he could have chosen, but this illustrates his point exactly, that there it's a bird that looks very like it, the birds look very like each other, but the beaks and the behaviors have diversified to accommodate different foodstuffs. And in his book he wrote, remember that he had thought of evolutionary theory, but he was keeping it secret at this particular time. This is 1844 when he wrote this. One might really fancy that from an original paucity of birds, that from there not being very many birds, that one species had been modified for different ends. We know that's what he was thinking, but you see how carefully he puts it here? He didn't want someone to point the finger and say, oh ho, so you're proposing evolution.
Okay, yeah, so in the MOOC there's a lot of information about showing the finches as an example of adaptive radiation. They're a very good example, a very obvious one, and one historically very important, but really the same sort of radiation and speciation has occurred in plants and animals throughout the world. Now, another animal that was very important to Darwin's thinkings and is very important in the Galapagos, the Galapagos tortoises, mm-hmm. and this is a very old drawing here.
Yes, this is a contemporary with Darwin's visit to the Galapagos, but it's not from any of Darwin's own writings. It's just here for illustrative purposes, for you to see the size of the things. This is a remarkably big tortoise. I don't think maybe Keith has been there, whether there are tortoises that size still today. Many of them of this enormous size were captured by sailors, just like this picture, and taken on the boats in order to be eaten. They were very useful organisms for nice meat and oil, and they were already packed, so to speak, in their shells. So many of the tortoises on the islands are now extinct because of this sort of over-culling in many ways.
Yeah, there were quite a bit of disturbance, and of course this is going back a long, probably 200 years before,
century.
Yeah, well before Darwin was there. The whalers were coming through and collecting tortoises and actually moving. There's some evidence now that they moved them around, or at least maybe not intentionally, maybe they were just loading and unloading and they fell off and got to different islands. But there's been sort of a human influence on the tortoise populations. And of course they're now all very well protected, and some of the races are doing very well. And there's been a breeding program for many years in the islands. This is one from the highlands of Santa Cruz, and it's got the classic dome shape. And of course that was one of the things that Darwin learned in from one of the governors of Galapagos, wasn't it?
Yes. There were people resident on the islands, and on the island that used to be called Charles Island, the resident, they called him the resident, told Darwin that he could tell which island the tortoises came from by the shape of the shell, particularly the shape of the shell around where the head and neck comes out of the shell. Sometimes it's bent upwards, sometimes it's flat. Here it's a classic domed shape. So Darwin wrote down in his field notes, tortoises special to each island. And here we have a really good indication just how much he wasn't thinking of evolution, that he wrote it down, it was an interesting fact, but it didn't trigger any of those important thoughts that would be triggered later on.
Yeah, okay. So that these dome-shaped animals are on islands where there's low vegetation that they can feed on, such as the grass shown here, or short cactus, or short plants, or whatever. And then this is an example of the saddle shape. As you can see, there's a big space above the neck, so the tortoises are able to lift their heads much higher. And these sorts of saddle-shaped tortoises are found on islands where the vegetation is higher, where the cactus is taller. And those are sort of the extremes, that in fact there are actually in several intermediates in between those. And this showing three different islands. Are these
are joined? These are contemporary with Darwin.
Right.
He collected some of the tortoise shells, and one of them was illustrated, but these are not Darwin's pictures.
Right, yeah.
But they are contemporary.
Okay. Now, this is just a landscape shot. Could you say something about what Darwin was impressed by?
Yes. Look at this landscape. It's almost like a moon landscape. It's very, very rocky. And to Darwin, this was exciting. It was volcanic. It's of volcanic origin, and we know that that's absolutely right. Here it's been weathered a little bit into crevasses. Occasionally there's a bit of soil. The islands are not all like this. Some of them have mountains in the middle with grass and trees and scrub. But this is generally the impression that Darwin got when the ship's men all landed, that it was a bare red and black volcanic landscape. And one of the reasons he was so interested in this was that he was thinking to himself, so how did animals and plants get a foothold on a landscape like this?
Yeah. So considering that Darwin visited, he went around the world and spent a lot of time on mainland South America and visited Australia, how important do you think the Galapagos were to him as a person and the development of his theories?
This archipelago was hugely important, and we do tend to talk it up, perhaps a little more than is justifiable, but the way Darwin responded to this landscape and the curious animals, the sense of being in the tropics and so many little island worlds completely self-contained, it meant a great deal to him emotionally and intellectually. So he enjoyed it very much when he was there, and the impact of what he had collected and found out about it was major when he got back into the British Isles and he was looking at his collections and thinking about those tiny little worlds, those islands so close to each other and yet so different in their animal life.
All right, we'll just talk about some of the more biological aspects of the MOOC this week. We've got just a polling question here, just yes or no. Are species distinct entities? And that's, we only give you two choices, yes or no, but I'll sort of give you, it's probably more complicated than that.
Well, you're giving them a clue.
Yeah. If you had to choose one way or the other, go for yes or no. Okay, so, all right, a bit of both, but mostly, but yes.
Yes, most of you have said yes, they are distinct entities.
Yeah. Okay,
what would your answer to that be, Keith?
Yeah.
It's tricky, isn't it?
It is tricky. I can cheat. I'm not being forced to say yes or no, but if I had to, I would say yes, but some are more distinct than others. Okay. In other words, evolution is a continuing process. It's not there's not necessarily a beginning and an end to it. And at any point in time, we just see a snapshot of that when we look at the animals around us. And some of the animals around us today are in the process of speciation. And so they are not as distinct mm-hmm. as those species that are, have undergone that process much longer in the future and have had time to diversify more. And also it has, as it sometimes has to do with things like physical barriers, like are evident on islands mm-hmm. where the ocean is a physical barrier. Mountain ranges or rivers or other things can form physical barriers as well. And so, yes, I would probably have to go with yes, but there are certainly some species that are not entirely distinct. And that brings us to the biological species concept, where we define, we have to come up with some definition, a mental construct for us to use. And we say that members of a species are able to interbreed and produce fertile offspring, which means that there is discontinuity between species. If they can't interbreed and produce fertile offspring, then they are separate species. But again, there are cases where that speciation process hasn't completed, and so you get, if for some reason they're brought back together, two that are on the pathway of becoming different species, they're brought together, they may still have that ability, and so they would probably still be the same species at that point in time. And this, of course, raises all sorts of issues for us in quantifying that. In other words, in our taxonomic classifications of animals, we talked about last week that Darwin studied his barnacles to get a really good appreciation of variation within a species as well as variation among species. And of course, we have a very good feel for, say, humans, and you can go to a crowd of, thousands of people, and everybody, you recognize everybody as being looking distinctly different from other people. But when you're looking at barnacles or some other group of animals, until you become very familiar with them, they all more or less look the same. But, as a biologist, I can say that once you really start looking at animals or plants, of course, that you see variation even within a species. So the question is then, how great does that variation have to become before you call them separate species? And in some cases, nowadays we understand, we have new tools, whereas originally species were defined on their morphology. Now we have other tools such as genetic markers and looking at the genome of species. And so both of these kinds of tools are used today to describe new species, to separate one species from another. And the best sort of studies tend to use both of these kinds of tools. And here's an example of cryptoblepharus, some Australian skinks in this area. They're pretty much all over Australia. Originally, there were seven species based on their morphology, and then Paul Horner, a scientist here at the museum in Darwin, studied them very carefully, looked at genetic markers, and found that there were, in fact, 24 species that are very, very similar morphologically. And so that's...
So seven species into 24?
Seven into wow. 24, So they would all look very similar to me, but even to Paul, after years of study, he couldn't recognize some species from the other. Often it's the case that you do these genetic tests and say, okay, this population is very different from another, and then you go back with fresh eyes and say, is there any difference? And then you find, this scale here around the mouth is different from that one. But But, you know, you would never, might not think to look at those scales beforehand. Now, we won't spend a lot of time on this, but just this is an example of a phylogeny, which is just a way of expressing relatedness among different organism groups, and these are vertebrate animals. And sort of one thing to understand is that the width of the diagrams, as over from the far left over to the far right, that sort of represents the time, or it's correlated with time. It's not in units of years or anything, but it's correlated with time, and the distance that animals help, or in this case these vertebrate animals, have diverged from one another. So if we look at the animals in the top, we have a top right-hand corner, we have a dog, a human, a mouse, an elephant, and an armadillo. These are all placental mammals, and they're relatively close to each other relative to all the rest of the animals illustrated here. And then the next, you can see that bar coming out that connects that group of mammals with the tamar wallaby and the opossum, which are also mammals, but they're marsupial mammals. And then the platypus is even farther out, and that's still a mammal, but an even more distantly related mammal, the monotreme. And then all the other, the birds, the reptiles, amphibians and fish, so forth, are even more distantly related from the mammals, and that's illustrated from those bars going off to the left side of the graph. So this is just one group of animals, and people at the University of Texas have gone to the trouble of collecting as many phylogenies of this sort that they could and putting them all together. And this is in a circular diagram, but they're diverging from the center. So you see a lot of close bars around the edges. Those are closely related organisms. And then the farther you get towards the center of the diagram, the more distance are the linkages. And so this includes the plants on the right, top right, and the protists or the single cell organisms, and then the bacteria, the fungi, and then the animals. And you probably can't read it, but that little writing right below animals that says just you are there. Here. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's where humans are.
That's us.
Yeah, it just gives you the idea of the diversity and the relatedness of these different groups. Now, types of selection. Of course, we talk about Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection, but that's one type of selection. And there are several different sorts of selection listed here. Artificial selection, which is humans choosing to make better domestic plants or domesticated animals, actively picking the best characteristics and then breeding for those. Natural selection is really the same process, but instead of humans doing the selecting, it's the natural environment, so the shortage of water or the shortage of food or predators or all sorts of selective forces reducing the population and selecting those characters blindly, I should say, selecting those characters based on things like the availability of these different resources. Sexual selection is, we'll talk a bit more about in a minute, but just briefly, that's where there's a choice, usually by the female, and that drives selection for male characteristics, and we'll look at some examples of that. The last two groups there, kin selection and group selection, are types of selection that don't work at the individual level but work at the group level. So kin selection is at the family group level, and group selection is even broader group. So which of these types of selection he really talked more, not only about natural selection, didn't he?
Darwin actually used all of these, but really put his emphasis most strongly on the first three. the book on the origin of species has at its heart an analogy between artificial and natural selection. That's Darwin's way of presenting his case, is that natural selection is like artificial selection, but without the human picking of desirable traits. Sexual selection, he put a great deal of effort into describing in one of his later books, and I think we're going to talk about that in a moment. He didn't use the words kin selection or group selection, but we know from looking at his writings that he had a handle on these sorts of concepts. He just didn't think that they were separate things or that it was necessary to give them names. So we can quite legitimately say that Darwin did use all of these concepts which have become so important in modern biology, but the last two, kin and group selection, he was less confident about.
Yeah, okay, so there's a question, can you give an example of kin selection? We're going to come to that in a minute. We'll talk about both of those, kin selection and group selection, in a few minutes. We're going to go through some polling exercises first, but we'll get to that.
So may I ask you a question about these types of selection? How have those ideas of Darwin's stood the test of time?
Yeah, okay. Well, last week we mentioned that Darwin really wasn't where the science of genetics hadn't been developed yet. And so first, when genetics first was developed, not really long after Darwin, it was really based on probabilities. So you get different crosses of peas and you look at colors of flowers and so forth. You get on probabilities of getting different colors, different ratios of colors, and that was very predictable. And so because that was so predictable, it was very obvious that something was going on at a genetic level, and so hence the birth of genetics. Later on, there was the discovery of chromosomes, and how they were lining up, during sexual reproduction, and so everyone then sort of said, well, that's probably the key to this is somewhere in these chromosomes. And then it was really quite a bit later, in our lifetime, that DNA was described and discovered, and then so there were many years where there was emphasis on the DNA in the chromosomes. And then even more recently, it's been discovered that there's DNA in other places. There's mitochondrial DNA that's passed on through the mother, only through mothers. And so all of these things, are new information that Darwin never had any inkling about, but none of them have really been upsetting to his fundamental theories. So none of them have sort of say, oh, in that case he was wrong. They're really just embellishments and getting at the exact mechanisms of how natural selection, how evolution by natural selection occurs. So I would say it's held up remarkably well for something, it's 150 years old. It's probably, when you look at other ideas and other fields of science, compare what we know now with what we knew 150 years ago, there's probably not many that would have stood the test of time as well as Darwin's ideas. So we can go through some activities. So you'll have three choices. We'll give some examples, and the choices here are sexual selection, natural selection, or some combination. And so the first example is here, is a peacock. So this is the male of the species, and they have this enormously elaborate tail. So do you think that is the result of sexual selection, natural selection, or both? So if you'd like to vote on those. I'll just move on to the next slide while you're doing that. And that sort of gives it away, in a sense. that there's the male and the female. So this is all for the benefit of the female. And so see what the responses are, but hopefully most people have selected sexual selection. So this is a characteristic of males, not females, that has resulted in females choosing the mates based on this trait. Now, there's a whole lot of speculation about why would they, why is that important? And there are different ideas about that. One is that, well, it's not really important, other than the fact that this male carries around this big tail, and despite having that, he's avoided predators up to this point. Has collected enough food up to this point to grow a tail that big and support it and so on and so forth. So there are correlates. There's nothing specifically magic about the tail. It's just that it correlates with other sort of fitness characteristics. And of course, when that female mates with that male, with the male with the biggest, brightest tail, her male offspring are more likely to have big bright tails, and also then they're more likely to contribute to future generations. Okay, another example. This is a frog, a marbled frog, which is very well camouflaged. So you can see it against the background of leaf litter in the forest. This is a local species around Darwin. And so do you think this camouflage is the result of sexual selection or natural selection? Let's see. A, B, and C. Or C, yeah. So A is sexual selection, B is natural selection, and C is... a bit of both. Okay. Well, it's having a bit of trouble getting answers up, but I would say that this is an example of natural selection. So there's really no sexual selection going on in this particular, yeah, there we go. Yep, so everybody agrees with that, natural selection. Now, bowerbirds, these bowers are not nests. They're, in fact, built by the males, and on sticks and ornaments, and are this trait, this characteristic of the males to build this result of natural selection, sexual selection, natural selection, or both. And it's sort of hard to ask the question without giving away the answer. When I said it's only the male, so it is sexual selection. But the reason we put this example in there, again, it's different, it's not a morphological characteristic, it's not a big flashy tail. It is a behavioral characteristic. So it's a sexual characteristic that's expressed in the behavior. And of course, there's all sorts of other behaviors associated with this. They go through, they use these bowers to display, and so there's other behaviors associated with the use of it. And it's interesting that the species here, this species is local to our region, and they're bowers on campus. And this particular species of bowerbird decorates its bowers with white and green, primarily. And so there's bits of bone there, shells, bleached out shells and white rocks, and then little bits of green, mostly human, human-related green, bits of glass and bottle tops and so forth. But other species of bowerbirds, there are other species in Australia and other parts of Australia and in New Guinea. And other species prefer different colors. So there's nothing magic about the colors and there's a certain randomness to evolution in the particular direction it goes. It's there's selection, so that don't mean to imply that it's completely random, but there has to be a mutation for a particular characteristic before selection can ever work on it. Okay, do humans have anything to do with artificially selecting peacocks? Mm. Oh, that's a good question. Probably nowadays they are a domesticated animal, but even before they were domesticated, they had this this enormous enormous tail. So certainly most of the fowl that we keep, chickens, if you ever go to an agricultural show, you'll see more different kinds of chickens than you ever, and ducks than you ever imagined would exist. Those are all the results of artificial selection. So yeah, I think that's probably a good point. Peacocks have probably also have undergone some artificial selection as well, but that didn't start out that way. Okay, this last example, we won't ask you the question, I'll just give you the answer, that this is an Irish elk, which is an extinct member of the deer family, and they were characterized by having these enormous antlers. All species of deer have antlers. The males only have antlers, so this is, again, a result of sexual selection. The males that have the biggest antlers, and these are not only ornamental, but they're actually used in combat sometimes. The males push against each other and lock horns, those are the males with typically with the biggest antlers are the ones that are most successful at mating, so that's a sexual characteristic. Of course, this has an enormous cost associated with it. Antlers, unlike horns, antlers are shed every year and then regrown. So, and of course, there's a tremendous amount of energy involved in growing a set of antlers like that every year once they reach adulthood. There's other resources like calcium. Calcium is, they're mostly made out of calcium. And then there's a cost of just carrying them around, so there's a cost to that. There's a cost to carrying around the big tail feathers of some birds that have, the males are sexually dimorphic. The males have really big tail feathers, and so these costs really run up against natural selection. So if the antlers get so big that the elk can't get between the trees, or they can't carry them around, or they then they butt up against natural selection. So natural selection and sexual selection can actually work in more or less opposing forces to get a balance of keeping these things from, well, sometimes they do look absurd, but they could presumably even be more absurd if it wasn't for natural selection. Now, we said earlier that we would, lost some words there, but said earlier that we'd come back and talk about kin selection and group selection. Kin selection was, as Janet mentioned, he recognized that the social insects, there's something unusual going on there, because those individuals, the worker bees, worker ants, worker wasps, have given up the ability to reproduce, and that's only done by the queens. And so that can be referred to as an altruistic behavior. They're working for the good of the colony at the expense of their reproductive output themselves. And so it's a special case of natural selection. Here's a more formal definition. Kin selection is natural selection operating at the level of the family. And the reason it can work at that level, as opposed to the level of the individual, is related to this idea of inclusive fitness. So fitness is an individual's reproductive fitness. How many offspring they produce, that live to survive, to reproduce themselves. That's a definition of fitness. So it's that individual's fitness plus that individual's influence on helping the to raise the reproductive fitness of its close relatives. And of course, close relatives share many genes. And so this is the whole idea of kin selection. It's not restricted to the social insects. There are some birds that breed cooperatively. They live together in family groups. The young birds stick around and help raise the next generation of birds before they eventually go off and try to raise their own families. So those sorts of behaviors are the results of kin selection. But the social insects are really the extreme end where they've just completely given up any possibility of reproducing themselves. Now, group selection is a similar sort of idea, except that the idea is where it's not necessarily closely related individuals. So you might have, it's been used to explain altruism that spreads within a group. So maybe a bird or some animal gives a warning call when there's a predator in it. Everyone who can hear that warning call will benefit from that altruistic behavior. And the reason it's altruistic is by giving that call, they're sort of saying they're giving away their location, or potentially giving away their location. Although there's a lot of evidence to show that those kinds of calls are really very difficult to locate, so they sort of use ventriloquism to avoid that problem. So this idea was popular in the past, but was used to explain a lot of social behavior and social groupings of different kinds of animals. But then later, other evolutionary biologists came along and said, well, really, when you think about that, there's a problem with this idea of group selection. That is that if selection is really working at the level of the group, because one individuals are foregoing or being altruistic and are risking their own reproductive potential, anytime you get a cheater, then in the long run, those cheaters should win out. In other words, those cheaters should leave more offspring in the long run. And so that's really been a problem with the whole idea of group selection.
So, Keith, is group selection still talked about today?
It is. It's still a topic. There's sort of couple of parts to the answer to that question. One is some evolutionary biologists have looked at, say, mathematical models or different kinds of models where under particular sets of circumstances, some people, a lot of biologists believe that there probably could be group selection, but under very restricted kind of circumstances. And so that's a sort of very esoteric way of that it's still being discussed among evolutionary biologists. But I don't think anybody these days is saying that it's really a very widespread phenomenon in nature. In other words, you can explain altruistic behavior in different ways that are results of natural selection. The other part answer to that question is group selection is often inadvertently promoted. In other words, people use phrases like "it's good for the good of the species," and really, evolution. If that were the case, that things were evolving because of the good of the species, that would be an example of group selection. But really, I think when people say those terms, it's not really justified. It's really sort of sloppy language, and really that most of those traits have evolved at the individual level rather than at the group level. Did Darwin have any comments on group selection? You briefly mentioned that he sort of knew that it might
be. Do you know,
be.
Yes, we've had a question here about did Darwin have any remarks to make about group selection? So he didn't formulate it in the way that we have just been discussing it, but he obviously saw that there would be some kind of selective value to groups working together. And so he understood this question as one of how do you explain altruism, or as Keith has just expressed it, something happening for the good of the species or for the good of the group. And yes, he did talk about it a little bit, but he was never very confident in what he had to say, I have to say. So he based much of his understanding of these kinds of issues on the social insects, on the ants, on the bees and the wasps, where he saw the workers in each one of those social insect species giving up things for the advantage of the group.
Yeah.
But we actually now explain that, I think, as kin selection.
Yeah, yeah. Yep, so that someone has asked examples of kin selection, so we've talked about the social insects are sort of the extreme example, but some of these bird groups that live together as family groups, have some of that behavior has also been attributed to kin selection. So yeah, getting back to the other question, did Darwin talk about it? He really spent years and years thinking about this, didn't he? There probably wasn't much that he... It didn't occur to him in some way or another.
Yes. So if you hunt around in Darwin's notebooks, you can find reflections on all of those issues. It's just that he never really talked about it in the way we talk about it now. You would hardly expect him to do that. And he never quite came up with an answer that we would find satisfactory now. Remember, he didn't have any genetics.
Yeah.
He was working 150 or 200 years ago.
Yeah. Okay, so here's a quick question about modern evolutionary biologists. And there's quite a bit of information in the second week's MOOC about the development of the thought all the way from before Darwin up to very recent times. So there's three choices here: Jack Roberts, Jimmy James, Stephen Jay Gould. So are any of those names familiar to you, A, B, or C? So I'll let you make a choice there. Okay, so yeah, so most people have picked Stephen Jay Gould, and that's, yep, that's right. He was it's worth mentioning him. The way, I guess, the reason we put him here is this quick quiz is that he made a couple of different contributions, I think, to the field of evolutionary biology. And one of them was to popularize the whole ideas. He was an excellent writer, very readable. He's written an enormous number of articles and books on the topic, around various topics around evolution. And so if you've never read anything by Stephen Jay Gould, I'd recommend it. And the other, he was a paleontologist at Harvard, and one of his contributions as a paleontologist was the idea of punctuated equilibrium. Or punctuated equilibria. And this is an idea that, well, I guess when Darwin thought about evolution, he thought about it how it was very gradual. Is that right? That it took many enormous amounts of time. And what the punctuated equilibrium idea is that there may be periods of time, very long periods of time, where very little change occurs, and then something happens and there's very rapid change, very rapid speciation, rapid evolutionary changes. And really, it's again, this is not anything that I think if Darwin had the benefit of looking at the paleontological record that we have now, he would have come to the same conclusion, and he would be sort of, he certainly wouldn't be upset by that idea, that, and really it's almost a confirmation of natural selection when you think that if you match, climate and the climate with the species living in that climate, the paleontological record, and are safe for some long period of time, a million years, for example, the climate's very steady, then there's not much change. And then you have something like a glacial, an ice age, the environment changes drastically, and immediately following that event, you get big extinction events, you get big rapid changes in big radiation events and changes within and between species. And so really it's not a different idea, it's just a matter of rates of evolutionary change. Okay, so speaking of paleontologists, they often are looking at fossils, and this is a skeleton, but could be a fossil. There's all sorts of evidence. The MOOC covers different types of evidence for evolution. There's embryological evidence, and then, of course, the paleontological record is very important, and nowadays we have much, it's still just because of the vagaries of something surviving for millions of years in a changing world with erosion and volcanoes and weathering of all sorts of events. It's really amazing that there are any fossils that are millions and millions of years old. But nowadays we have a very extensive fossil record for many plant and animal groups. And then the other form of evidence for evolution, another form of evidence for evolution, is comparative anatomy. And this is a whale flipper, so the front appendages of a whale flipper. And those bones that you see are homologous to our arm bones, upper arm, the ulna and the radius, and the forearm, and then the wrist bones, and the hand and finger bones. And so when you look at a whale's flipper from the outside on an intact whale, it doesn't look anything at all like a hand or an arm and a hand. But when you look at it this way, and you know what you're looking for, they're very similar indeed. And this next slide, this is quite an old drawing from 1863 of a gibbon, an orangutan, a chimpanzee, a gorilla, and a human. And if you look at these skeletons, they're all the same, really. I mean, they're just different proportions, they're different shapes. The jaws are quite different. The lengths of the arm are quite different. But all the bones have the same names. They're all the bones are there. There's no missing bones in humans gorillas, and chimpanzees don't have any extra bones that help them climb trees or whatever. And so when you look at it from that point of view, then it's remarkable how these homologies or homologous structures have maintained remain similar throughout time. So that brings us to the whole topic of human evolution. And Darwin really didn't talk about it in The Origin very much. He sort of mentioned it, but then later he wrote another book, The Descent of Man. Why do you think he separated those two topics, or the human topic, out from the other topic?
There's a lot of debate about this, of course, but it does seem that Darwin quite deliberately avoided talking about human beings in The Origin of Species because he quite rightly understood that would cause huge controversy. There was huge controversy even without humans being in the book. So if he had put humans in the book too, I think he believed that the theory would not get a full and fair hearing. And it's no question, we know from his notebooks and all kinds of other things, his correspondence, that he thought human beings were the subject of evolutionary change, that we had descended from apes of various kinds, just like this picture. This is a picture that was drawn by his great friend, Thomas Henry Huxley, and was a very significant illustration in all the debates after The Origin of Species was published. So Darwin just held his fire, and that's difficult for us to quite comprehend today because scientists don't tend to hold their fire now. People publish as quickly as they can. Nowadays, different then, Darwin wanted to be right. He wanted to wait until the moment was ready to publish his own views about human origins, which were pretty radical. And as we've just heard, he put all his notes together and produced a very fine book called The Descent of Man in 1871, in which he talked in different chapters all the way through the possibility of human ancestors being apes, or the animal origins of human beings. So he covered comparative anatomy, embryology. In those days, he had very little knowledge of the fossil record. There were hardly any fossil human remains for any scholar to draw on, but he put what he could in there, the classificatory relationships, and on and on. So he did come out quite loud and clear about ape origins for humans, but it wasn't until 1871, quite some time after he published The Origin of Species.
So, yeah, so that's about 12 years or so in between. Had the political climate or the social climate changed much? Was it more accepted?
Yes, I think it's really quite interesting how all those debates relating to evolution in the widest sense after Darwin published, and all the other people started contributing to the debates, and it went global. As we'd say today, it went viral very rapidly. There was lots and lots of opinion expressed about evolution in general and in particular. So by the time Darwin came to publish, it was easier. Yeah. People were familiar with it. Of course, there was still debate. People were horrified to learn that they might be a cousin of a gorilla. But the tone of the anxiety was a bit different. So it was good for him to wait.
Right.
And he put together a lot of information during those years that he didn't have access to before.
So you mentioned that he wanted to be right. Mm. Do you think, so that was obviously a big part of it, but do you think, was he also apprehensive? Do you think he really suffered from, thinking about the backlash? That much?
Yes, he did. He was anxious. There's no question about it. He knew he had this brilliant idea that was very difficult for people to understand. It was hard enough even for the scientists to understand what he was proposing. But when you add in all the other stuff about disregarding the traditional Christian stories, by implication suggesting that human beings were not special. There's all kinds of things that went with Darwin's proposals that made him anxious, made him cautious, made him careful, so that The Origin of Species was as careful as he could possibly get. And by the time he came to write The Descent of Man, he says to a friend, I've been accused of hiding my views, so I would like to publish these now, 20 years later.
Okay, a couple more activities. Which of these birds has vestigial wings? An emu, a rhea, great spotted kiwi, or all of the above? Now, while you're thinking about that, I'll just go to the next slide, which defines vestigial. Just take one last quick look at those three birds. Okay, vestigial is an organ. If you look at the second definition there, or the biological definition, is an organ or part of the body that degenerates, is rudimentary, or atrophied, having become functionless during the course of evolution. So we're talking about the wings of A, the emu, B, the South American equivalent of an emu, the rhea, and Brady spotted kiwi from New Zealand, or all of the above. So I'd like to vote. Yep, most people say, yep, all of the above. So that's right. In this example, all three birds, I'll just quickly go back, all three birds have vestigial wings. They're all flightless birds. Now, we have a similar sort of question. It's a little bit trickier, though. Which of these birds has vestigial wings? Wedge-tailed eagle, Galapagos penguin, or penguins in general. This is a Galapagos penguin. Or the flightless cormorant, which is also a Galapagos bird. So which of these birds has vestigial wings? A, B, or C? Which I think we could have made this even harder, even trickier by saying D is B or C, B and C. Okay, so they're pretty evenly divided between B and C. Okay, well, the tricky bit of this question is that, well, flightless cormorants are flightless, and when they swim with their feet. So their wings really are not useful, not used for anything. Whereas penguins don't fly in the air, but they fly in the water. So penguins use their wings to propel themselves through the water. So I would say that even though they're modified into a flipper, they're still very functional. It's still a wing, even though we call it a flipper, but it's, if you look again, look at the bones and the anatomy, it's not unlike a typical bird wing. So and they use them to fly in the water instead of in the air. So penguins don't really have vestigial wings, they just have specialized wings.
So why do organs or wings and limbs in this instance, why do they become vestigial?
Okay, so if the ecology of the animal changes, and they start spending most of their lives in the water, feeding on fish and so forth, and the wings or the organ is not being used, then you would think, well, okay, it's not being used. Why does it get small and useless like a kiwi wing? Why doesn't it just stay normal? Well, that's a difficult question. It's not impossible for that to happen. So they could just stay the same, but there is a cost there. So there's a cost to growing a wing. There's metabolic cost to maintaining wings, a big wing that's not being, and if it's not being used, then all of those costs could be better used for other forms of energy expenditure. So a vestigial or an organ that's not being used doesn't automatically become small and withered, but if there's no selection forced to keep it strong. And so if there's a mutation that makes it a bit smaller, that won't be selected against. And over time, those sorts of mutations will accumulate because there's no disadvantage to those mutations to accumulate. And so often the result, if it's not used, then it becomes small and insignificant.
So it's a kind of back to front evidence for evolution.
Yeah. 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 That's right. So it is. It's evolution in the opposite direction.
The other way.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. I have a couple more slides to go. Just very quickly, to reiterate something I said earlier, that evolution is still occurring. It's not something that occurred in the past, and we just look at it in fossils. And a very good example is antibiotic resistance. That's human caused, so it's artificial selection, but it's inadvertent. We're not trying to get more potent, deadly bacteria, but that is the result of say, the use and maybe the overuse of antibiotics, is that the bacteria themselves are evolving and becoming more resistant to antibiotics. So that's evolution happening in the lab or in the hospital, or you know, in humans. Okay, I think this is the last slide. Just very briefly, just mention, go back to the Galapagos before we leave, and these are three of the four species of iguanas on the Galapagos. They're the two on the left, the one or two land iguanas. There's actually a third species, a sort of famous pink species that was only fairly recently discovered in the 1990s and described as a separate species. The three land iguanas, and then the brightly colored one on the side of the slide is a marine iguana. And there's a couple of points here. First of all, just the fact that there are three land iguanas and only one species of marine iguana relates to the fact that although marine iguanas don't normally strike out and swim from one island to the other, they're always in or near the sea, and by accident, it's pretty easy to imagine them getting caught in a current and go to a different island. And so there is some genetic connectivity among marine iguanas, whereas the land iguanas are on different islands, isolated, and if there's very little opportunity for them to move from one island to the next. Although the pink iguana there are two species on that island, Isabella, that's the largest of the islands, sort of a horseshoe, a seahorse-shaped island that is, but again, there's a physical barrier. Because there are five different volcanoes on that island, and there's a lot of volcanic activity over time, and so there are vast areas that are just completely naked, fresh lava, and that lava is renewed periodically over the years, so that there's very little vegetation in big strips. So effectively, that island is, although it's a big island, is cut into different islands by these seas of lava, and eventually plants move into the lava fields. But like I said, they're often, because these are such active volcanoes, those lava fields are often renewed, and there's very little chance for movement from the north of the island to the south of the island, for example, and so that's become isolated, and that's probably how the pink iguana came to be. The other point to make about the marine iguanas is, although they're all considered one species, there are some differences. So in the North Islands, they're quite small. On the West Islands, Isabella, the one I was just talking about, and Fernandina, the most farther to the west, the marine iguanas there are enormous, bigger than the land iguanas. They're very big. So there's a lot of variation in size. There's variation in, although they're mostly black, this is these colors here, this green and red, are breeding coloration of an island, of a marine iguana on the island of Española. And other islands, the marine iguanas don't have that sort of breeding coloration. And so there, you could imagine that if there were a more effective barrier, long enough time, that marine iguanas would probably speciate. But there's probably just enough gene flow, because they're in the sea, to prevent that, or at least it has so far. But it's still an ongoing process.
So diversification's still happening.
Yeah, very much so. Yeah, very much so. Okay, I think that brings us to the end of the material today. Just two last things to mention. First of all, next week the MOOC will not be on Wednesday, it will be on Friday, and it'll be at a different time, at 11:30 a.m. Darwin time. So don't look for us on Wednesday. And finally, I would just like to again thank Janet Browne for joining us for these last 2 weeks, and it's really been a pleasure having you.
Thank you, Keith. It's been lots of fun. It's been particularly good to talk to you about this, but it's also been nice to join in with all of you listening.
Okay, thank you.